everyone. The message you are about to watch is a message preached by Bishop Opudeli Eze. This message is packed full. It is anointed, it is fire-right, it is loaded, and it has the capacity to put you on your throne of enthronement. I want to encourage you as you watch this message, watch it with faith in your heart, because God will impart some great measure of anointing in your life. Yokes will be broken, chains will be destroyed, walls will crumble as you watch this message. I want you to watch it with faith in your heart and trust God that every situation in your life will turn around for good in the name of Jesus. Amen. Happy New Year.
Let's look at Luke chapter number 2 and verse 40. You'll be blessed. Please, if you've got your Bibles, we'd like you to rise to your feet as we honor and reference the reading of God's word this morning. Praise God. Let's read together. One, two, go. And the child grew and was strong in the spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. My prayer for you, that at the end of today's service, may the grace of God find expression through you. Galatians chapter number 4 and verse 19. Galatians chapter number 4 and verse 19. Praise Lord. The Bible says, my little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in me. Can I hear you say, in me? Please be seated, bring out your writing pads as I take you through a journey in the world. A journey in the world. You see, one of the ways to grow and mature in the things of the Spirit is through consistency of exposure to faith food. In the realms of the physical, if a man must grow and maintain energy and all his operations intact, that man must, as a product of intentionality, must always eat food. He must be able to eat food. So it is in the realms of the spiritual. If you catch to grow and mature your dimensions in God, you must always expose yourself to faith food. And faith food is the word of God. The faith food is the word of God. So friends, this morning, I want us to look at the subject, understanding 8 fundamental principles of spiritual growth. Understanding 8 fundamental principles of spiritual growth. Understanding 8 fundamental principles of spiritual growth. I would like us to understand that God desires every child to grow. Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6, the Bible said, unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given. That means in the kingdom, there is a distinction between children and sons. At the point of salvation, you are simply a spiritual babe. Who is a spiritual babe? A spiritual babe is that person that have just come into the family of Christ. You just gave your life to Christ, and there is need for growth. There is need for you to move to the next level of reality. So in this kingdom, we have children and we have sons. And of course, you can be able to walk in the dimensions of your right and your abilities until you are able to transition from being a child to a son. God brings you into the kingdom as a babe, but he expects you to mature as a son so that he can be able to confer on you your authority and your right, so that you can be able to maximize relationship with the Father. Now, while studying the book of Galatians, chapter number 4, Paul said, and he, as long as he's a child, he differeth nothing from a servant, but he is kept under tutors and governors until the time that is appointed by the Father. That scripture is simply saying, at the point of coming to Christ, you are a babe. So you are kept under the ministry of teachers and the ministry of the fivefold governmental power to nurture you, to disciple you, to harness your abilities until a Christ-like maturity is formed in thee. You know, the problem we have had in this kingdom is that we have people who come into the kingdom as babes, and after many years, they remain as babes. There is no growth, there is no development, there's not, you know, they are not able to walk in the gifts of God. They cannot be able to exercise dominion, not because it has not been made available for them, but because they have not been able to grow. From where we saw in Luke chapter 2 verse 40, the Bible said, and Jesus grew in stature, in wisdom. There was a growth. He was able to transition in dimensions of capacity. He was able to grow, and because he was able to grow, he came into the realms of sonship. He came into the realms of sonship. Now, I would like us to know that the ultimate desire of God for every child of God is for us to look like Jesus. I said it again. The utmost desire of God for every child of God is for us to grow and to mature and to walk in the realms of maturity like Jesus. Each time God looks from heaven and look to the new creation, he wants somebody whose fundamental abilities in Christ has been developed, breathed upon, and you are maximizing your ability, not as a child, but as a son. You know, my responsibility this morning is to move you from a babe to a son. If you stand up and say amen, you will be a son. Like I said, there is a child of God, and there is what? A son of God. So, in between the timeline of being a child and a son, there is what? Growth. 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 So, God wants us to grow. So, I'm going to be sharing with us 8 fundamental principles that when you engage them, you are going to metamorphose from the regions of being a child. Look at me. God cannot allow you to function in the gift of the Spirit and command believers' authority if you are not mature. He doesn't give his giftings and his grace to those who have not been tutored and mentored. That is why I am spending this first service to tell you there is a treasure of God on your inside. There is an ability of divinity in your humanity, and God wants to stir it up in order to make you a deity on the earth. But there is no way you can function without understanding until you are shown typically what you must have to do in order to be a giant. So let's move. Spiritual growth is the process of maturing. Spiritual growth is the process of maturing in the things of God. Spiritual growth is the process of maturing in the things of God and walking in your rights and privileges as a believer. I would like you to pen that down. Spiritual growth is the process of maturing in the things of God and walking in your rights and privileges as a believer. I'll take that again. I said spiritual growth is the process of maturing in the things of God. You mature in the things of God, and you walk in your right, and you walk in your privilege as a believer. Paul said in the book of Galatians chapter 4 verse 19, my children, in whom I travail in bedpans again, until Christ be formed in thee. The ultimate destination in this new creation is Christ. God wants you to be like Christ in character, in ability, in hugeness of grace, in demonstration of virtue. God wants you to be like Christ. So there is possibility of growth in Christ. Thank God you are born again. Thank God you are spirit filled. But the question is, are you walking in your rights and privileges as a child of God? Has Christ been formed in thee? Paul said, for thou hast not learned Christ. So Christ is learned. So there is every ability to mature and to grow. So I'm going to give you 8 principles that will make us to mature. If you keep to them, your life will be on fire and you manifest God's power. Can I hear you shout glory? Number one, learn to forget. Learn to forget. Do you want to grow in the things of God? You must learn to forget. Philippians chapter 3, verse 13 and 14. Philippians chapter number 3, 13 and 14. God's word declares, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. Can we say forgetting? Can I hear you say forgetting? Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. Glory to Jesus. And verse 14, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. So number one principle that will bring you into the realms of maturity is that you must learn to forget. Now, as we talk about forgetting, there are two things you must forget. Number one, you must forget your past achievement or successes. Forget your past achievement or successes that can hinder your quest for more progress. You must forget your past achievement. You must forget your past glory that might be an hindrance. Look at what Paul said. I can't know myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind. What are the things that are behind? The successes of yesterday, the prayers answered of yesterday, the anointing and demonstration of yesterday, the little breakthroughs of yesterday. Paul said, if you want to continue, the Bible said in the book of Proverbs chapter 4 verse 7 that the pathway of the righteous is like a shining light that is shineth brighter and brighter even unto the perfect day. Can I get an amen in this house? The next thing you need to forget is your past mistakes and confess sins. Your past mistake and confess sin. I want you to know when God forgives, he forgets. I'm trying to say that another thing you need to, you know, many a times in our down moment, Satan will begin to replay a theme of our sins of the past, which we have done the due diligence, which we have prayed over, we have confessed over, and Satan will begin to say, is it not because of the sex you had the other day? Is it not because of the abortion of yesterday? Is it not because of the money you stole? Is it not because of that? Is it not because of that? Now the truth of the matter is, once you come to the revelation of Christ and you confess your sin, he blots them away. He doesn't remember them anymore. So you must, number one, forget the achievement of yesterday in order to get spurred up to enter into the deeper things of the Spirit. And number two, you must forget your past mistakes and confess sin. All of us are coming from somewhere and going to somewhere. Can I say it again? Every one of us, we are coming from somewhere and we are going to... If God beams such light on your life in the last 20 years, look at me, some of us will not greet you anymore. We have done that, and we have come from all manner of iniquity and sin. But look at me. The Bible said in the days of ignorance, God wins at us. He wins. But now you have come into the reality of who you are in Christ. I want you to know that at the point of confession, he blots your sins away and he forgives your sin. Forgiving. Can I have some scriptures? Isaiah 43 verse 25. Isaiah 43 verse 25. Look at me. These are the 8 things that have changed my life in the last 18 years of walk with Christ. If I'm able to download this thing into your spirit and you begin to walk by then, I give you the next 1 year, you become fire. So I hear you. All right. Show me Isaiah 43 verse 25. Look at what the Bible says. Even I am he that blotted out thy transgression. Can you see that? Can you see that? For my own sake, I will not remember thy... Another New Testament scripture, Hebrews 8 and verse 12. Hebrews 8 and verse 12. Hebrews 8 and verse 12. Can I see? Oh, I love Jesus so much. Can we look at this scripture, everybody? One, two, go. For what? Can we read one, two, go? For I will be merciful to their what? And their will I? When? So the one thing you need to forget, you must forget those two things, your past achievement that could be a hindrance for advancement in the pursuance of your vision, and to forget the past mistakes and confess sins. Some say, I hear you. Number two, learn to forgive. Do you want to grow spiritually? Learn to forgive. Unforgiveness is like a man who drank poison and he is expecting someone else to die. Help me tell somebody, learn to forgive. I can't hear you. Say it again. Shout it, let devil hear your voice. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 32. In the course of journey of life, offense will arise. Offense will arise, be it husband and wife, be it friends, be it a church member. But you see, one of the cardinal virtues that any man that must go far in life is the virtue of forgiveness. You cannot maintain largeness of heart if you have not cultivated the ability to forgive. You know why you need to forgive? You were once a sinner and you were forgiven. The problem is that the people who were forgiven find it difficult to forgive others. That's the problem. Each time you have this understanding, I was once a sinner, condemned, and Christ came and died for us. By the release of the blood of Jesus, I was sanctified. My sins were blotted away. Now, each time somebody is around you, you must find somehow, you must find the capacity to say, I forgive you as Jesus has forgiven. Paul will always say, for Christ's sake. For Ephesians chapter 4 verse 32. And be ye kind one to another, tender hearted, forgiving one another. Can we shout forgiving one another? Even as God forward, Christ's sake, had forgiven you. So if you always bear it at the back of your heart that God forgave you for Christ's sake, then you must learn the ability and the grace to forgive one another. So for you to maintain the peace and the serenity of the spiritual atmosphere, nothing pollutes the spiritual terrain like bitterness of soul, like unforgiveness. This one offended me, this one offended you, look at me. Many a times, humorously, each time I share along this line, I always ask people, since you became human, has your teeth ever bitten your tongue before? Has it ever happened? Did you use AK-47 to shoot all your teeth, or use a hammer to pluck at your tongue? So why didn't you do that? Huh? You're laughing. That is how it is. As long as there is life, you will offend me and I will offend. Hey, talk to me. You will offend me and I will what? So you need to realize that forgiveness is a virtue and we must exercise it for Christ's sake. Number three, learn to pray always. How do I grow spiritually? Learn to pray always. The book of Luke chapter 18 verse 1 says, for men ought to pray always and faint not. And he spoke a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray. How often should you pray? Church, talk to me. How often should you pray? Look at me. Prayer is very essential if you are going to sustain the faith. So the sustenance of the faith is the word and prayer. Show me Jude verse 20. To develop spiritual muscle, you must pray always. To develop spiritual muscle, I commonly tell people, no man is more powerful than his prayer life. You cannot be more powerful than your prayer life. No man is more powerful than his prayer life. Prayer is not the ministry we do. Prayer is who we are. That is who we are. Acts chapter 6 verse 4, we shall give ourselves continually to the world, to the ministry of prayer. Is who we are. It's in our gene. It's in our spiritual DNA. Our Lord Jesus, when he walked the earth, prayed and prayed until his sweat became a lump of what? Became a lump of blood. Isaiah chapter 66 verse 8, he said, and when Zion travail, Zion deliver. Look at me, look at me. It's possible to live on earth and you hear God's promises without it coming to pass. Prayer is a converter. If you want to see the efficacy of prophecy, commit to consistent, ongoing, fervent intercession. James put it this way, Brother James. He said, Elijah, is he not a man with like passion? And he prayed, the heavens were shut. He prayed again. And this man was remote controlling heavens by prayer. So there's no way. We'll be down here. We'll be coming here doing 5 hours. I see my sons. I stretch them. But because no papa is in their midst, they can't miss. We pray from 12 to 5 since Monday. 5 hours. When you're doing, even your snot is changing gear. Somebody else is in the church praying. Have you seen why if you offend pastors, God want to kill you? Because the pains we pay and the burdens we bear, only eternity can reward us. Only eternity. You should honor pastor. If you have money, bless your pastor. Buy suit, buy car. Because the pains and their sacrifices, life cannot pay it. Last Friday, we are two prayer warriors. We are one side, but the same flow. 5 hours. 5 hours. You know what it means to pray for 5 hours? 5 hours? We're not praying because we are hungry. We're not praying because we don't have what to eat. We are praying because that is the life wire of the church. If pastor goes to sleep, the devil will use the members as a barbecue. Even come on, say amen here is a reflection that your prayer life is dead. I know it now. You are so tired. Why wouldn't you be tired? Did you ever spend 1 hour, 2 hours this week that ended? But you are eating a good beans in the afternoon, amala in the night, everything, the table you are eating. But you cannot pray. There is no way you can sustain spiritual stamina. That's the only way. At my level of being a bishop, being a minister, getting to 20 years, I can still leave my family and come to church and humble myself and pray. Then what else am I looking for? That's the only way to grow. That's the only way to sustain faith. Faith can be tried. Storms of life are real. But the only way to keep spiritually afloat is to pray and pray and pray and pray and pray. If you're under me as a seed and you're not a prayerful person, you won't survive long here. You should go to those churches where they do magic. No, they don't do magic here. Everything we do here is on the principles of believing God, releasing our faith through prayer. Can I shout amen? If you are getting what I'm saying, wave your hand and shout hallelujah. So you must pray. Let's look at what Brother Jude said in Jude chapter 1 and verse 20. Jude chapter 1 verse 20. Awesome God, I love you so much. But yea, beloved. Can we read it? 1, 2, go. But yea, beloved, building up what? So faith can be built up, isn't it? And how do we build our faith? By what? Make it a lifestyle. Make it a consistency of flow. Every day you owe God a tithe of 2 hours, 40 minutes in prayer. 2 hours, 40 minutes is the tithe of 24 hours. Pray, for men ought to pray. And number 4, how else do I grow spiritually? Learn to believe. Learn to believe. Luke chapter 1 verse 45 says, blessed is she that believe, because there must be a performance of those things which we are told her from the Lord. Learn to believe God and his word. despite your current circumstances. Learn to believe God and His word, even in the midst of storms of life. Learn to believe God and His word, even in the face of the worst adversity, because your adversity is the platform for your advancement. Paul said, for a great and effectual door has opened before us, but they are not without adversary. Therefore, my adversary is the platform for my advancement. You need to believe God that what He told you in the dark is what you are going to see in light. That the God of the valley is the God of the mountain. The God that saw Abraham through, and saw David through, and saw Rahab through, and saw Jesus through. In the same that Jesus died and was laid at the belly of the earth for 3 days, and the Bible said that Jesus was raised by the Spirit of the Father. If the Spirit of Him that raised Jesus dwelleth in us, this same Spirit shall now quicken our mortal body. You've got to come to a point where, whether it's raining, whether it's burning, I've made up my mind. I love Jesus. I'm going to follow Him through. The economy will not suggest what I eat. What the circumstances of life is not the definition of who I am. I believe God in life, and I believe God with all my heart. Throw your hands in the air and shout, I believe. I believe you've been blessed by that word of enthronement that came your way. Solidly in my heart, I believe that your life will never be the same again. In case you're out there, you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, quickly I would like you to chant this prayer. Say, dear Lord Jesus.
Dear Lord Jesus.
I come to you. A sinner. I confess. From today.
I receive you. Into my life.
As my Lord.
And personal Savior.
Never to sin again. Congratulations.
Amen.
You are now sanctified, blood-bought, and anointed for exploits.
Amen.
I want to speak specially to those who listen to the word of God. I declare by the mercies of God,
yes,
that every yoke of limitation in your life is broken.
Amen.
I speak that the land where you are will not deny you your treasures.
Amen.
I declare when it is your time to be blessed, it will not be negotiated.
Amen.
I decree by the mystery of the word of God,
yes,
may you have access to divine inheritance.
Amen.
I declare healing to your body.
Amen.
I declare fruitfulness to everybody's situation.
Amen.
Receive grace for financial empowerment.
Amen.
Go and excel.
Amen.
Subdue the land.
Amen.
Manifest dominion.
Amen.
In the name of the Father.
Amen.
And of the Son.
Amen.
And of the Holy.
Amen. Thank you for watching the message of enthronement. And I believe that miracles are already happening in your life right now.
Hallelujah.
Want to encourage you to follow us on Facebook and other social platforms. You can see the links scrolling on your screen right now. And the headquarters of the church is located at Zion Heritage and Miracle Ministries off Voice of Nigeria Way, Luwe Airport Road, Abuja. And we have so many other branches. The branches and their addresses will also be scrolling on your screens right now. So stay connected with us and remain lifted for life.